Assalamu alaikum ji. I thank you everybody first of all for making it here this morning. I know it's rough. I'm surprised I'm here myself. I was telling the organizers, like, don't you know filmmakers? We could never be here at 10 in the morning. But thank you for showing up. And before I introduce our panelists, I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself and my journey in cinema. My name is Adnan Malik. I moved back to Pakistan about 9 years ago. Having studied film, and at the time it was quite a taboo, my father kept saying, my son, he's studying media, because it still was, there was still a stigma associated with it. I majored in film, so I came back here and I really wanted to figure out my own place in the cinema history of Pakistan. My generation also didn't really connect with cinema here. My parents' generation did. So one of the first things I did was make a documentary on Pakistani cinema. It was called Bhuli Hui Hu Dastan. It's a feature-length documentary film on Pakistani cinema. It also features heavily features Nadeem Manvivala, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. And it sort of was just, it's an archive of what's happened over the last 60 years in cinema. And the conclusion that I came to in the film was basically whatever's been happening, cinema is sort of a mirror, it's a reflection of what's been happening in our country. So the film was sort of couched like that. And today's conversation is really about the fall and the rise. And so I'm briefly gonna talk about the fall, and I think I'm gonna let our panelists talk a little bit more about the rise, because we wanna be positive here and look into the future. I'm just going to bring up some of the salient points. Something like in 1974, we had 125 films produced in Pakistan. We were one of the top 10 film producing countries of the world. We had good government support in the sense that we had an organization called NAFDEC. There was a lot of forward movement in cinema. There was government support. And even though our films necessarily didn't win a lot of prizes internationally, they were catering to the local market. But there were certain pivotal moments that sort of brought around what is the so-called demise, and I'm just going to touch on them briefly. Obviously, the first one was losing Dhaka as a film center, 1964. You know, losing East Pakistan, and when Bangladesh came into fruition, we lost a huge film center. So that was, you know, already our market was divided by half. Then Indian films being banned here and Pakistani films being banned in India, right before the 1971 war. And so before that, you still had films that were playing on both sides of the border, which were from the other country. And then obviously in the 70s, also during Bhutto's time, there was a lot of the Islamization process started. So, you know, things like the language riots, which actually, and this is in my documentary, gave rise to the idea of the Tota, which we can discuss later. But and of course, the PNA movement in which they started, you know, creating legislation separately for Muslims and for non-Muslims, and which ended in Ziaul Haq's sort of reign when he came in. And the day that he came in, 300 films were banned overnight. Those 300 films, some of them, of course, were promiscuous or lascivious in nature, but a lot of them were sort of political statements that were also banned under the same couch. And another thing that happened at that time was that PTV came up. PTV Karachi had come up, and people sort of moved towards television. Cinema became increasingly peripheral, and Indian films were begun to watch. People began to watch them at home once the VCR came in. So obviously, so people were still watching Indian films, but we weren't watching them in cinemas. Pakistani cinema had a bit of a taboo, and. And then films started becoming increasingly regional and in the vernacular. So Punjabi cinema really took off in the whole Sultan Rahi movement. And I think the final nail in the coffin was actually in 2001 when cable television was allowed into the country. Because what that basically did was that people could stay at home and watch about 80, 90 channels for 100 rupees or 150 rupees. And people just stopped going to the cinema in general. That along with, of course, the banning of Indian films. So for the last few years, with the increase in the number of screens, changes in digital technology, which make films easier to make, and policy shifts to let in more Indian films, and the success of a few big so-called nationalistic films, there have been rumors of a revival. The revival hasn't happened. It's a bit like Boy Cries Wolf. And that's what we're going to be here to discuss today. So I have with me two panelists. First of all, unfortunately, I'd like to apologize on behalf of well, all of us, we couldn't have Javed Sheikh here. He hasn't been able to make it. He might show up, but we needed to start, so we're sad about that. But of course, I have with me someone who represents a new generation of filmmakers in Pakistan. Just recently produced a film called Seedlings, which got a lot of attention at the New York International Film Festival. And of course, she's a producer, Meher Jafri. And Mr. Nadeem Manvivala, who's a staunch supporter of cinema and the owner of Atrium Cinema and Nishat Cinema, as well as a film distributor. So, nice to have you guys here.
Assalamu alaikum, thank you.
So I'm going to start with something a little philosophical. What, according to you, is the role and the purpose of having a cinema, a vibrant cinema culture in a country like Pakistan?
Adnan, I've always believed that out of every audiovisual medium, cinema still remains the most strongest medium of audiovisual. So, for me, the significance is huge. Now, how do you utilize it? That's up to you. Every nation is utilizing in their own way. Our problem has remained that we, like many other things, we have been very confused that what we are doing is correct or what we are doing is wrong. And usually what happens with our society is, unless and until we finish everything, we don't visualize that what's coming on us. Once we finish, then we cry and then we make amends. So we are doing the same thing with the film industry. We finished it, we destroyed it, and once it was on the brink of destruction, we started crying about it, and we made amends. And we are now on a rebuilding. I will not call it a revival for one reason, that there is a humongous gap between your old cinema and your new cinema. At this moment, Pakistan is experiencing two completely different cinemas. One is 1960s and 70s, and one is 2012. So automatically, even the audience and the audience we have for the movies is completely different in these cinemas. Before, we did not have this difference. We had one kind of a cinema and one kind of an audience. But now there is a big change in the audience. Every kind of an audience is experiencing and coming to the cinemas.
Right.
So automatically, the flow of pictures is also changing tremendously.
We're going to come to that in great detail actually after this. But just to pass the baton on to you, Meher, as someone who's an independent film producer, and you know, you've studied abroad, you know the way Pakistan has also been perceived in the West. I mean, I have a great quote here actually. I don't know how great it is, but I looked it up this morning. But now more than ever, we needed to talk to each other, to listen to each other and understand how we see the world. And cinema is the best medium for doing this. It's just Scorsese. But what is your take? Like, why is it important?
Yeah, no, I mean, it's pretty obvious in a country like Pakistan where the literacy rate is so low. And here TV and film are not mutually exclusive. But as visual mediums, and this goes along with the other performing arts, it's probably one of the most important ways of communicating, and it's a way of getting to people who are not able to access maybe stories like that or messages that they might see in cinema, you know, get across something, whether it's emotionally or rationally or whatever the message of your film or whatever it is. It's the easiest and the best way and the most effective way to actually engage with an audience. So whatever point you're trying to make, whether it's entertainment, whether it's politically motivated or socially motivated message, I think cinema, I mean, it's a no-brainer. Any visual medium is the best way to get across to an audience such as is in Pakistan.
Right. I mean, another, I think, very important point to bring up is, you know, there seems to be an increasing lack of public spaces where people of different walks of life can interact in. And I think cinema also plays that role. And I think that's important to bring up in a society like ours where we're getting increasingly fragmented. You know, the use of public space, sitting together, watching something together, even just that idea, and taking ownership and taking pride over something that is necessary, you know, that is something that's been created out of here.
Yep, that's exactly it. I mean, cafes, well, cafes are now everywhere, but libraries and cinemas and places like that were kind of dying out. The culture of that was dying out. So it's very, very important to bring them back, because you're exactly right. Unless you share the same personal space with other people and are truly interacting with them, we're not gonna, the conversations are gonna be very superficial for a very long time.
Sure, and I think also, I think, unfortunately, this is my thing, but I think as a country, we suffer from self-esteem issues. So I think, again, I think cinema is a great way to sort of express yourself and express your voice and share it with the world. But the real question here, and what we're here to discuss today, is it really a revival? You know, we've had two films that have done really well in the last 7 or 8 years. Nadeemji, correct me if I'm wrong. Khuda Ke Liye and Bol. Both of them have been funded by people who don't necessarily want to make their money back. So they aren't business model films where it's actually necessarily making the industry itself a lot better. And there's a ton of films in pre-production, and I'd just like to bring those up just so we know. There's a cricket film that Humayun Saeed is producing. It's right now the title, I believe, is Boom Boom Afridi. There's a film called Zinda Bhag, a film called War, which again is ISPR sponsored, film called Chambeli. Hamad Khan, who made Slakistan, is making a film called This Is Not a Sermon, This Must Be a Dream. There's a film called Kaptan. Jami is producing a couple of films. One of them's working title is One. Summer Nix has just directed a film. It's called The Extortionist, and it's in post-production. And then there's a bunch of small films that have come out that haven't actually been able to come into the cinema, called Gol Chakkar, of course, Seedlings, and a film called Josh, and of course, Sabia Sumar's latest film. And we can keep mentioning these films, but none of them have really come out yet, and that revival hasn't quite happened. So is it a revival? Is it going to be a revival? Is it Boy Who Cries Wolf?
Okay, let's put it this way. Whenever you want to do something, you need to believe in it, whether you can do it or you cannot do it. And then it has to be proven in reality. Now, as you said, Bol and Khuda Ke Liye were exceptions. We do agree that they were exceptions because they had the backing and everything. But they did prove, you see, the difference between cinema and television is, television you can control, cinema you cannot.
In what way?
Cinema is only controlled by the public.
Right.
Unless and until you make a good film, the public is not going to, because public is paying for it.
Yeah.
It's not coming free to them. Shoaib Mansoor proved 2 points, which was very necessary for our theory to get proven too. And he has proved both. One, can we make a movie? Do we have the expertise, or do we have the talent to make one? He proved that, yes, we do. Now, he has proved the notion. Now, whether others can make it or not, that is to be seen. The other one, can we make such movies which will go internationally? Not only for Pakistan. Because up till now, whatever we have made has remained in Pakistan and not gone internationally. So he proved both the points that yes, we can make a movie, we have the talent, and we can make movies which will go and run in international cinema. And that is what is necessary for your rebuilding. I keep saying this to everybody, we, for 65 years, Pakistan film industry has made films for Pakistan, not for anywhere else. Now the new generation has to consciously make films not only for Pakistan but for the international market.
Why is that important, do you think?
It is important because limitations of a market.
I'm just going to rephrase the question. Do you think the first step is to actually make cinema for people in Pakistan and then look to make cinema internationally, or do you
I'm not
things?
Saying to make films for international.
Right.
I'm saying making films for Pakistan which are acceptable internationally. If you are going to make below standard films, if your quality is not going to be that good, if your content is not going to be that good, then automatically the international market is not going to take the films.
Right.
Which has been the case. But if your content is that good and if your quality is that good, no international market is going to say no to you. If you are a business model for them, automatically they would like to make business from you. So in my opinion, the rebuilding has started, not the revival, because this is again a new generation which is proving everything.
Sure. And speaking of that new generation, Mehr, what is your opinion on this in terms of making films? You know, you made Seedlings. What was the audience for that film in your mind when you guys went in to produce that? And it hasn't released here, but you have played it in festivals abroad. So to add on to what Nadeem Saab was just saying.
The audience for the film was, I mean, it was always intended to be for Pakistani audiences. And I remember when we were going...
Also or first? Or I'm just curious, as a
first.
Producer, what were you looking...
First, always first.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a huge, huge market. It's a whole country. So you're going to find it doesn't have to be typified by a certain... So in the beginning when we were making it and we were looking for sponsorships or we were looking for some distribution interest beforehand, we were told a lot that it doesn't fit the Bollywood formula. So it doesn't... It's not going to make it. So that kind of, I mean, that's very, I'd say, backward thinking in the sense that it's there's so many different markets. You have Charles and Keith over here. It doesn't mean the masses of Pakistan is going to go into making that store successful. There's a certain market that you have. I'm not saying Seedlings is a Charles and Keith, but, you know, there's different, the idea is that you have to be smart enough to know how to market your film and who to market your film to, and
right.
You have to know your audiences. So I'd say our audiences are pretty much a lot of the people who are sitting over here.
Right.
When we went to New York and when we went to then Canada and now we're gearing up to go to London, the audiences, the expat audiences were pretty much, I mean, we were floored by the reception that we got over there. We had three screenings, all were sold out in two of the festivals. And so to that, that just kind of legitimized or was gratifying in a certain way because we'd worked so hard to try to get it released over here, and it was really kind of very disheartening to see to see the response here. Because the thing is that you can make the film, but to get it to the audience, there's a big
void.
Yeah, there's a big thing blocking your way. That's the distribution industry, and the few people that are controlling the distribution industry. It's not about them either. It's the economics of how many screens there are and things like that. But so to get through that barrier, it's very difficult. So to have it go abroad and have it internationally recognized and win the awards, that's all amazing. But the idea is to have it released over here. And we had that chance last week in Lahore because the films, the Lums Film Festival, they invited us. So it was like our homecoming and we were thrilled. And we had a wonderful reception over there. And that just kind of brought back the whole energy because it's been really tiring trying to do this. And we keep being asked on our Facebook page, we keep getting like, you know, you like to go to London, you like to go here, you like to go to New York, but Pakistan, when will you release it here?
Right.
And that's the biggest question. How can we do that?
Well, I think we're going to approach that question in a little bit, but I want to come back and ask Nadeem, someone who's the owner of a cinema, and whether there should be a mandate for Pakistani films to play here. You know, we can figure that out right after. But what I want to ask you a little bit is, and what you mentioned, is about the economic side. Let's really talk about the business of cinema. Because I know that you're a big proponent of sort of supply side economics here, and the role that Indian films have had in terms of potentially improving our own cinema scene here.
Well, Adnan, you'll be surprised.
Speak up a little bit.
The last 2 years, we have taken out the percentages. 57% contribution came from the Hollywood films. 43% was Bollywood. So it don't make it that big that Bollywood is only the only thing which we are considering for. It's the quality of films. It's coming from both sides.
Okay.
It's not only Bollywood that the audience. Yes, Bollywood does have a larger audience.
It's because of the language as well.
Because of the
and
language.
The shared cultural heritage.
There's a big. But it's more effective in other areas rather than in the metro cities. As far as Mehr's question is. You must try and understand, when you go abroad in a very developed infrastructure. Mm. Now, getting things done there is very, very easy. We have just started, and there is too much to do. Now, some will get the chance, some will not get the chance. Who doesn't will always cry, who does will always be very happy. Mm. So, you have to be patient like many other things. We have been very patient. We have fought for it for the last 25 years. Appreciate that the forum is there. Today you have a platform. Yesterday you didn't. Mm. So at least That is something what we are looking on. Yes, we are trying. We are creating a platform for every filmmaker in the country who is experimenting on digital media. Even the cinemas are getting digitalized.
Right.
So more cinemas are getting digitalized, automatically that opportunity will become bigger.
You had mentioned something to me that you're working on a platform where sort of young filmmakers who are making things or older filmmakers who are making work on the digital medium.
Yes,
perhaps
we
will get an opportunity to screen their films. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Basically, it's an idea between me and Jerji Seja of AIY Digital. And we thought of this, that a lot of people who are trying, because you see, for us, the most important thing, cinemas are not going to come overnight. So it is going to take a long time before you can have a complete infrastructure of cinemas rebuild it. Now, what do you do till that time? Do you sit and wait that the cinemas will be made and then we start making films? Or you start making films now? Because filmmaking, again, I keep saying this even in the highest forums of the government, that to make a good film, you have to practice. You have to make films. Pakistan at this moment is not making films. Because in the meetings which we have, every time the producers go there, one question comes up. Why can't we make one good film? You don't make films. How can you make a good film? So you have to start making films, and that was the concept behind the idea that if we make a platform of in somehow to bring these pictures into the cinemas, so at least every filmmaker will know that if I can make something good, I will see the light in the cinemas. I will have a platform, I will get a chance, and then let the public decide.
But this platform, is it separate from a commercial platform? Because obviously small independent films that are made on small budgets can't compete against the Bung 2.
Yeah.
Fine.
Right? So
fine.
Is there going to be a separate, like that's what I'm wondering, like should there be a separate mandate or a separate a business plan for these independent films so that, like for example, I was associate producer on this film called Slackistan, a very small film, but it didn't get the distribution here. Then, you know, there was that...
I thought it was banned. It didn't get through the censors.
It wasn't banned, but that's another thing. But at the end of the day, it didn't play. Or like
it didn't play.
Omar Khan's horror film, or whatever the smaller films, and now
no,
let's
at that time.
And
now let me say, let me tell you, Ziba Khana.
Yeah, Ziba Khana.
Ziba Khana did get released, but that was not the right platform.
Yeah.
He was releasing the picture on a DVD. DVD is not a standard of the cinema. We cannot play films. I was the only one who refused to play it when I was running DHS Cinema. And Umar also got very upset. Even Jio got very upset because they were releasing the film. But you have to know that you have to come to the minimum standards of a professional organization. Cinema is not your home.
Right.
Cinema is a public place. And it's a very professional place. So automatically, you also need to understand, you can't just say that I made a home movie, please run it in the cinema. Let's see whether the audience comes or not.
Right. So let's, one thing that I think is important to bring out here is, and I touched on it earlier, is sort of the supply side economics here. You've been saying you're a big proponent of the fact that once more cinemas open, the ceiling of the amount of money a film can make is going to make it more feasible for a Pakistani film to be made. So to say that again, let's say like the potential of a film in Pakistan to make the amount of money it can make is $1 million, right? If it can make $1 million, if an Indian film or a Hollywood film in Pakistan can make $1 million, then it's feasible for someone in Pakistan to, let's say, invest $500,000 in a film because they know that they can make $1 million back from that film. So how important is the construction of new cinemas and how is that helping the potential market for Pakistan? Because I think you believe that once there are more screens...
Let me tell you, the maths is very easy for everyone to understand.
Please, because I'm tripping over my words here.
If you make 1 rupee in the first week, you will make another rupee in the entire run of the film.
Mm.
So you will make 2 rupees. Mm. Right? So it is all dependent what you do in the first week. Now that's the model which is being used in India at the moment. This is the model which is being used in America. In the entire Hollywood, what the film makes in the first week will make in the entire run of the film. And that is exactly the average which is coming in at this moment with all our films. With the exception of one or two, otherwise every film is creating that average. Now, what we are concentrating on is how can we bring that first week from 1 rupee to 10 crores? The day we will bring that to 10 crores, we have touched 5 crores, by the way. We started from 1.5 and we have touched, within these 3-4 years, we have touched 5. So there is a great development which is happening. And I don't see very big time to go. It's probably another 2-3 years where we will touch those 10 crores.
And what do you mean by that?
You see, when you gross, let's say you gross a collection, box office collection of 10 crores, 50% is taken by the cinemas. So you are left over with 50% of the amount.
Right.
That's 5 crores.
Ah, okay.
Right?
Right.
Now, if I make a movie, let's say of 2, 3 or 4 crore rupees, I need to get my money back in the first week. Nobody knows what is going to happen in the second week. Because there, the public decides.
Right.
Either your picture will run or it will go. It will be a disaster. So we need to recover whatever we are putting in. That is what the model everywhere in the world is. Everybody needs to recover. If they don't turn up in the first week, you're gone.
Right. So recently you told me that Race 2, which is an Indian film, is now the highest growing film.
Yes. Race 2 is now going to cross nearly about $900,000. So right. We are touching $1 million, but in the entire run.
Right.
What we need to do is to get there in the first week. We need to do $1 million with a very big picture in the first week. So if a very huge picture like Race 2, Dabang, Shah Rukh Khan, if they are doing $1 million, you will do 50% of it. So even if you do 50%, that is 5 crore rupees, then automatically your recovery will become 2.5.
I'm going to ask a couple more questions, then we'll open it up to the audience, and maybe Meher, you can also. How is a Pakistani film ever going to compete with an Indian film? How do you think that? But how is it? Because we have the same language.
It's very easy.
Yeah.
India has a market of 10 crore rupees. You have a market open of 100 crore rupees. Think about it.
In theory.
No, not in theory. In reality. Because Shoaib Mansoor has already proved that his pictures were released. You need to change your mindset as a maker, that the world is open for you.
But where am I going to get the funding from? Because no one's going to...
If you set your mind to it, if you can raise funds for Pakistan, you will be able to raise funds for the whole world. This is not the question, ke how the money will come. Your mindset has to change. We are not changing our mindset. India did. 15 years back, India was not dependent on the international market. They completely changed their mindset that we have to capture the international market. And today they have. 30 to 40% of their revenue is coming from the international market. And it's growing. So automatically, when you create your mindset, you start. It's a collective effort. It's not an individual effort. Then everybody starts thinking about it. Okay, what needs to be done? How are you going to capture? You are not going to capture international market in 1 year. It will take you 10 years. But then you have to work for 10 years for it. If you keep saying that if I don't have the funds, how will I go about it? So you will not get anywhere. We wouldn't. We believed in it that we can make cinemas like that. I kept on hearing for last 25, 30 years that these cinemas can never be made in Pakistan. But we did it. So when you have a mindset to it, you will be able to do it.
But I do want to add that films like Bol or Khuda Ke Liye, like you mentioned before, they're not they shouldn't, because money is, of course, a concern with films. I mean, TV is different, but money for films is the biggest concern.
And the only way a film can make its money back in Pakistan is by people actually going to the cinema, not through music rights or DVD rights or television rights or any of those things. So,
but with those films that you had mentioned, for example, and that you mentioned also, they were not governed by purely, let's say, market forces, or they were not commercial films in the truest sense, because they were subsidized and they were patronized by the industry at that point. And so all the marketing prowess that goes into that here and in India, that makes a huge difference. But having said that, if it wasn't for those two films, I don't think the Pakistani cinema would even be a question in people's minds, because they did pave the way. So that actually brings us back to the question that maybe the some form of subsidy, I mean, this was a very commercially backed film with a very, I mean, a very, let's say, pointed point of view, and the people who were backing it, that's fine. But it was a subsidization or a patronization of that film that led to Pakistani cinema being opened up to international audiences.
Sure.
That maybe let Seedlings
facilitated something like Seedlings.
Completely.
There's a lot we can talk about, but I think we should open it up for questions. And do people have questions so we can get the dialogue sort of moving forward? Is there a mic? So I think over here.
I'll just say one very simple thing. I'm from India. Just as your writers have, they're such a fantastic story, such a moving story, compelling story to hear from Pakistani writers. And the same with cinema, you should be able to reach out and tell the world those stories. There is such an amazing, Pakistan is at the crossroads of so many things that are happening. I was wondering, what is Meher's film about? And since you have a filmic distributor there, why can't he show her film all over Pakistan?
Well played.
It's a drama, and it's about a couple who lose their child in an accident, and he opens a year in the aftermath with the husband and the wife dealing with the grief of that, and the third person who's responsible for the accident. It is a character-based piece. When you have very limited budgets, you tend to go for character-based pieces rather than the theatrics of, you know, something else. So that's what the film is about. And as for the second part of the question, I think I'll hand that over.
Yeah, why hasn't this film screened yet?
Before we started this, Meher and Adnan and I were talking about it. And Meher said that you have been very busy and I've been trying to get a meeting from you. And whenever I call, you're not there. So this time I told her that, Meher, please don't take a time, just come. And we will sit down and we will talk about it. So we are still waiting for that meeting to happen. So as soon as that meeting happens, probably the things will go forward.
If we could pass the mic on,
I'll hold you on that.
I think you should just keep passing the mic afterwards.
Also from India, and I have another question. Actually, two questions. Because you mentioned the fact that Indian films are doing very well abroad because of the fact that they've gone international. I just want to clarify one point. It's not that they're accepted by the mass audiences in the US and the UK, but by the NRI audiences. They're being made largely for the thousands and millions of Indians who live abroad. I don't know whether you have the same advantage, you know, that Indian cinema has, therefore. So when you say going international, you must clarify, because a lot of the Indian films do not do well in mainstream cinema
halls
abroad.
You'll be surprised to know abroad.
Yeah.
Your biggest audience is Pakistanis.
Okay, so that brings me to my second question, which is that, you know, it always makes sense to do collaborative cinema. And I think wherever we've had examples of Pakistani I'm not sure about writers, but certainly actors, going there and working there, it's been very, very successful. So, I mean, maybe to start with, couldn't there be a major platform, or is that something you don't want to see happen that often because it doesn't really help you, in a sense, bring up the industry here, the local industry? And by the way, I loved Slackistan.
I would like to give you an answer on that. There are issues on the government level when actors go there or, they are acting there. It is already happening. Maybe it is not happening on a large scale, but actors are working there. Javed Sheikh Saab, who is, was unable to come today, he is working there.
Speaking to
and also, some of our very prominent singers are doing a lot of job there. So that has already started. And that's the opening I was talking about. That opening was never there for last 40 years. People from here could not go there. People from there could not come here. So that's a great advantage. And let's utilize it. Just not let go with it that they can come here, but we cannot go there. You have to keep your mindset to this, that if you are welcoming them, they are also not saying no to you. They are also welcoming you. Nobody is saying no to you. But you need to go there and work for it. Nobody is going to come and take you there.
Sure.
And you'll be surprised. That was the first demand of our film industry, that Indian film industry should invite us. Now, that's where we are wrong. That is the mindset that we are going totally wrong. Nobody is going to invite you. You have to go there. You have to make your presence felt. And by your work, they will appreciate you. And they are doing it.
Right. I think another thing also I'd like to add, and you said, is that something that you feel uncomfortable about? I mean, I'm a big fan of Indian cinema has gone. But I also do, to a certain degree, think that we need to develop our own sort of cultural ethos. And I think it's important to do that also, because the marketing machine behind Indian cinema has become so strong that we were constantly inundated by it. And there's a cultural tussle happening here, where at one there's an increased religious polarization. At another level, like, everyone's watching, Indian cinema with it, all its color and its dancing. And, the moral compass is slightly different. Unfortunately, it is what it is. So I think it's very important that we also focus on what's important to us. So some of it should be done indigenously. And I think our strength is basically a social drama. And I think that, and a lot of that is coming out in our television, and that's evolving itself, because we have had a strong ethos in the past. And I think it's time, through cinema, that we redefine who we are and present ourselves to the world.
I wanted to actually go back to what Adnan Malik had earlier asked, which is, why should we be looking at an international audience, but in the garb of increasing the quality of movie making? We are 180 million people, and as you, Meher, pointed out, it's the visual art. So we don't require literacy, and those who are making the movie are sufficiently professional enough to actually make a visual art presentation. And what Adnan has just exactly appropriately said, there is a cultural ethos, and the focus on being Pakistani, whatever that may be, if that is actually the driver of improving and broadening Pakistani films, maybe automatically we will be developing a niche in this country. Mm-hmm. So like with everything else in Pakistan, which is donor driven, whether it is audience or marketing or positioning or privileging, that is probably fundamentally our problem. And if we look at Bollywood, it is only very recent that they even looked at the international market for the NRIs. They remained for Indians, by Indians, because they had sufficient enough people. And they went into maybe stage 3 or 4 looking at an international market. So I think I would ask the question both to Mr. Mandewala, that this obsession of, like, change your mentality but increase the quality, which is actually looking outside of Pakistan, I'd reverse it and go back to what Anand was saying. How do we do it indigenously? Mm. How do we raise the money? How do we focus on Pakistan and still remain high quality and competitive?
You want to take that first?
No, please, you start.
I'd say I can only speak from experience about Seedlings and the journey that we've been has been so far. Is that for the survival of independent films in Pakistan, like Seedlings, like Josh, like Slackistan, I'm guessing, international audiences have been very important, because now our ability to sell this film has kind of, it's been the biggest, the most difficult thing in Pakistan, and probably because of the number of screens or the lack thereof, or for whatever reasons, or perhaps there's certain people who have a typification of what type of films work over here, and hence they won't take it on. So for no other reason than the fact that we haven't been able to bring it over here, the international market is very important for us in terms of selling it, and then in terms of being, that obviously brings about the sustainability of your filmmaking, you know, ventures. But I'd say within Pakistan, you're exactly right. Unless we put films out like this, we will never be able to develop that niche that we can then evolve into a different type of film than the film that has, again, been typified as what would be the only type of film to work over here. And then you're going to perpetuate that cycle. Then there'll only be films with guns and violence and terrorism and things like that, which is great. That's entertaining. That makes for good quality cinema. But there are other audiences also. I'm personally one of those people. So there has to be some type of, and Adnan was touching upon this, about creating platforms, maybe smaller cinemas. I mean, for every AMC and multiplex abroad, there is a Tribeca cinema or a smaller. So it just comes back to the economics and the number of screens in Pakistan, and that Nadeem Saab will be able to comment more on.
I would comment to you a little bluntly. All the forums or all the mediums which are used in filmmaking, we as a nation don't pay for it. We try to get it free of charge. Now, when you don't pay for the talent or for the project, our DVD structure is completely pirated. Our cable structure is completely pirated. So you're left with only cinema. Every project you make, it bears a cost. The better it is, the bigger the cost is. So automatically, when you say that depend on Pakistan, please let us know how to depend on Pakistan. Because every Pakistani would like to see your film free of charge. So if I keep making films and everybody keeps stealing it, how do I make big money? And that is why you need the international market, because internationally you do get paid. They do pay. So likewise, we need to change some basic regulations in this country also. If you want to support your films, if you want to support your talent, then automatically you have to start paying for it.
Okay, let's do a couple more questions, please.
Yeah. Hello. Hello.
Then we'll have to call it.
Yeah. I'm Rafa Mahmood, I write for the Express Tribune newspaper. My question was partially answered when Adnan spoke about the cultural ethos bit. The question is that we are surrounded by two of the most dominating cinemas in the world. We have a commercially driven Bollywood on one side, and we have the artsy Iranian cinema on the other. My question is, hopefully, if all of the things that you three of you are saying go in the right direction, 10 years down the line, what is the image of Pakistani cinema that you see? Because you have Iran on one side and you have India on the other side. So how do you see 10 years down the line an image of Pakistani cinema?
I think all three of us would answer that differently. So I'll start. I'm hopeful. I'm a bit of a dreamer. I think it's gonna, and I don't know if Nadeem ji agrees with me, but I think it's gonna take one big film to really get the things in motion, one big successful, commercially viable film. I think a lot of people are looking at Humayun Saeed's film to be, because it's a business model that can be replicated again. It's not something that's subsidized by somebody else, because it is a big film. It's got corporates involved. If it does well, the corporates will jump on and it'll become, and that'll become the market. Mm-hmm. But I don't necessarily want it to be something that apes Indian cinema. So I think a lot of it should draw from television. And I think hopefully we'll create our own niche, which is somewhere in between. Sort of the Iran suffers or benefits from a lot of censorship, right? And then Bollywood, I feel like, is a bit over the top. And I think somewhere within our own way, it'll be a mix of sort of social drama with a little bit of masala in it, hopefully. But I do think it'll come up. I do think, I mean, and when we have people like Nadeem Ji, who's really a big supporter of cinema, I think with more screens opening up, I think Pakistani cinema in the next 3 years, we should be producing about at least 10 to 15 good films. I'm hopeful. I think in 3 to 4 years, yeah.
Well, I mean, and you've heard the story over and over in Rafi, is that, again, when I come back to the number of screens, and so the future is bright, because I know there's a lot of new cinemas that are in development right now. I don't know, it's difficult for me to say. I think the next 10 years will be very good for film. Making the film is the easy part, getting it distributed is the hardest part. So that's not something that I know or I can predict as how the distribution industry will pan out. And then with that comes marketing, that's huge. You cannot have a cinema industry that doesn't know how to market the films. The cinemas just won't be successful. So I think it really just comes down to the distribution and the marketing industries and see what type of films. And a lot, like with the funding that Adnan said, if corporate sponsors begin to, like he mentioned the Humayun Saeed's film right now, that will be a very, very big commercial hit in my opinion. It's about cricket. The country is craving watching good cricket since they're in real life, they're kind of a bit disappointed sometimes. So that's going to be a really, really good film that's going to come out. So sponsorships, things like that. Now, if sponsors can move away from, not move away, but also include other types of film, then the future of Pakistani cinema is bright. But it is, it just comes down to how many screens will pan out over the next 5 to 10 years.
My would be very differently put. I take very similarity between the markets like India and Pakistan. There is a big similarity between England and America. England is a very small market. America is a very big market. Pakistan again is a limited market. India is a very big market. So how do we see? We can only see it with the experience they had. England cannot make Indiana Jones. But when England makes Shakespeare in Love, that is also world-renowned. And they take all the Academy Awards for it. And they come up on the stage and they say that we are British. So automatically, this is what I see after 10 years. You will never be able to make Dabang, but definitely you will be able to make Shakespeare in Love. And that is what we are trying, that at least create that platform that you can get there.
Unfortunately, we've run out of time. I wish we had some more time. I want to thank everybody. I just want to say a couple of things. Just want to thank the Citizens Archive of Pakistan. They put up some posters. We did a project recently of Pakistani cinema art, and those posters are put up there so you guys can appreciate them. And also, the volunteers, they have a DVD of the documentary I made called Bhuli Hui Daastan. I bought 30 of them just to give away. So if you'd like them, you can just talk to her. And final words.
I'm cutting you out. I've asked Adnan that 8 years back he made this documentary and he needs to make another one now. But I would like to know, what will you call it now? It's not Bulivi anymore.
It's not. Something hopeful. I'm sorry, there we don't have a... Well, Kara would have been great. It was a fantastic platform. Definitely, I think film festivals play a really important role, and the time is right now for a film festival as opposed to 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I have spoken to people about it. Thank you, everyone. That's a good point. I just want to thank you guys so much, Nadeem Mandiwala, Meher Jafri. Thank you so much for your time and patience, everybody. You're a great audience.